It's 2022 and you want Wi-Fi 6. Of course, Wi-Fi 6 has many new features that make Wi-Fi better, especially when you have multiple clients connecting to one single access point. But which Wi-Fi router to choose? There are so many. One decisive argument to me personally, of course, is whether the device is supported by OpenWrt or not. I just want to be able to choose which software to run on my Wi-Fi router. With this in mind, there is one device standing out at the moment. That is the Belkin RT3200, which is actually identical to the Linksys EA8450. In this video, we will check the performance of that device with the original firmware. Then, we want to see how we can flash OpenWrt on that device. I also want to give you an idea what the status of Wi-Fi 6 is with OpenWrt, and of course, we will test the performance and compare to stock firmware. Let's first have a quick look at the device. It does stand out in a couple of ways, I think, really. First off, I found it quite big and heavy. It weighs a whopping 650 grams. For my viewers in the US, that's roughly 23 ounces. My Archer C7 weighs 420 grams and the Xiaomi Mi 4A is as light as 230 grams. The RT3200 has a unique optical design. No external antennas, no wall mounts, and is clearly intended to stand on a shelf or table. Two LEDs at the front, 5 gigabit Ethernet connectors at the back, a USB connector, a WPS and reset switch, as well as a power connector and an on-off switch. The case has holes at the bottom, which are nicely held above the ground by those 2 feet here, so that air can circulate through the device and out through the holes at the top. All information about the device is printed on the bottom, such as the serial number and initial passwords. I like it. Nice design. Oh, quick disclaimer at this point. I am not affiliated with Belkin or Linksys in any way. They don't pay me for this video. I bought the router myself and paid for it myself. By the way, if you want to buy one, then please use my affiliate links in the description. I will then earn a small commission on your purchase, but you won't pay more. Presumably, I won't become rich with that, but it might at least pay for coffee. Many thanks, guys. Now, let's have a look at the performance of the device with the original firmware. As I do not have any Wi-Fi 6 equipment here, we will be limited to Wi-Fi 5 functionalities, but we will have a look at multi-user MIMO. MU-MIMO, and antenna beamforming as well as airtime fairness. But let's start with the Ethernet throughput. Guys, the test layout is very simple and explained in my last videos. Just in a nutshell, I'm using iPerf 3 as a tool to pump a data stream through the router in various modes. First, the switch performance. Then the routing performance, so the network address translation, or rather masquerading performance. As expected, both look good. I would assume that the device can easily go up to 1 gigabit and that the bandwidth limitations, which we have just seen here, were largely limited to my network, because I have in fact 3 switches and a router in between the test points here. So, not bad at all. Now, let's have a look at Wi-Fi. This is where things will become very interesting. First, I want to check the capabilities of the access point. As I do not have shell access into the device, I will just scan it from the outside as follows. I run a shell on a Linux laptop with Wi-Fi hardware and launch the IW scan command, which will scan the air for all access points and output the signal strength and also the capabilities of that access point, such as beamforming. But wait, what does beamforming actually mean? The Wi-Fi 5 standard, or 802.11ac, introduced various techniques to make Wi-Fi better. And with better in this context, we don't necessarily mean the overall maximum bandwidth or the reach of the Wi-Fi signal, but rather improvements when connecting to an access point with multiple clients. Wi-Fi 6 has some more of those. How does that work? In a classic, so pre-Wi-Fi 5 installation, the clients would have to wait until they got a fair share of the airtime before they could send or receive data on a channel. This is mainly related to the fact that most AP hardware, access point hardware, has omnidirectional antennas. That means antennas that would submit the signal everywhere at the same power level in a kind of donut-shaped sphere that is parallel to the ground level. That is the so-called beam pattern of these antennas. With Wi-Fi 5, a new technology called antenna steering or beamforming has been introduced. With these features, the antennas are used to direct the signal onto a specific client. But how can you actually change the beam pattern or directional characteristic of an antenna without physically changing it? The idea behind this is that if we have multiple omnidirectional antennas and we don't send on all of them at the same power, but let's say very high power on the first one, a bit less on the second one, and much less on the third one, then the directional characteristic of that antenna group changes. We can hence form a beam with software. We can steer the antenna electronically without changing its physical shape. In order for this to work, the hardware and firmware and driver all need to have the beamforming capability on one side and the beamforme capability on the other. With beamforming and multi-user MIMO, an access point can hence talk to multiple clients at the same time on different spatial streams. Now, let's go for the Wi-Fi test. And this test scenario differs a little bit from the last videos. So let me explain. I have three Wi-Fi clients here, which are positioned at different distances and angles from the access point. An iPhone 11, an iPhone X, and a quite recent Lenovo laptop, which all have beamforme capable Wi-Fi hardware inside. On the server side, I have iPerf 3 running on three different ports, and each of those windows actually represents the speed of one of the clients. Let's connect the first client. It gets up to 700 megabits. When I ran iPerf 3 in the local network, I could get up to 800 megabits. So that's presumably the maximum that I would get with two substreams. Again, I'm not so much interested in the total bandwidth. I'm sure that's more than excellent, but rather how the device performs when multiple clients connect. Let's connect to the second client. We can see a quite fair airtime schedule here. Both clients get good bandwidth. Now I will add the third one. The bandwidth on the third one is not so high because I only have four streams to share. You can actually see two of the clients competing for the second stream here. But overall, the share that each client gets is really good. The total bandwidth remains at around 600 megabits. That's what counts. I get the whole bandwidth shared equally among all clients. Awesome. Let's double check. I switch off beamforming in the router's admin interface and run the tests again. Here we can clearly see that the result is totally different. The clients are competing for airtime. They don't always get a fair share. Sometimes one client gets it all, sometimes the total performance drops dramatically. That's actually one reason why so many people experience bad Wi-Fi at home. Their access points just can't cope with many clients streaming high volumes at the same time. Cool. That should have shown the MIMO and beamforming capabilities of that device. Overall, excellent performance. Wired and wireless. Nothing to complain really. Just two things which I could not test here. First, the Wi-Fi 6 or AX capabilities, as I do not have Wi-Fi 6 hardware in the house. And second, as I do not have shell access to the device, without opening the case or breaking into it, I could not check on the CPU usage. But as this device presumably uses the proprietary vendor's drivers, I would assume that it can offload a great deal of CPU load to the hardware. Awesome. Let's go and flash OpenWrt. If I go to the OpenWrt firmware selector page, then I can see that there seem to be two different versions of the firmware available. At the time of making this video, that is in January 2022, there is only support for the snapshot version, which is good because it means that support in the release will follow soon. At the moment though, I have to select snapshot. But what's the difference between those two versions here? Let's check the hardware page of the device on OpenWrt. Actually, the TOH, the table of hardware, should always be your first stop if you want to check if your device is supported by OpenWrt or not. Here we can see that the device has a lot of flash and RAM. That's good. And if we scroll a bit further down, then we can see the secret lifted. There is a special flash layout on this device, which is not necessarily optimized. So you have the option to either keep that layout if you just want to try out OpenWrt and potentially return to stock firmware, or you may use a special installer for that device and convert the memory layout. Cool. So I have flashed OpenWrt on the device, and now let's go and do some performance tests. The test layout is the same. Just now, the top window shows the CPU usage of the device and the bottom window shows the network performance. First, the switch performance. No surprise here. The device offloads to the switch hardware, so we get the whopping 940 megabits over the switch at 0% CPU in both directions. Then the NAT and masquerade performance. That shows approximately the same figures. No surprise neither, the CPU goes up quite high. Anyhow, let me enable hardware offloading in Lucy. Here we go. Test this again. And beautiful, we get the full gigabit speed at close to 0% CPU utilization. And now for Wi-Fi. Here I thought I'd lean myself a bit farther out of the window really. The stock firmware only offered us 4 channels in the lower 5 GHz band. Actually, those are the channels which can be used without weather radar detection or dynamic frequency selection DFS. Now, OpenWrt is much more flexible here. I thought, hey, why not try out the 160 MHz band with automatic frequency selection? This should give us a theoretical maximum speed of up to 2.3 gigabits using QAM 256 modulation, if all conditions are met. Guys, quick remark on the weather radar and dynamic frequencies here. If you want to use channels 52 and above, then you absolutely need to make sure that you select the right regulatory domain here in Lucy. That's the country code here. The reason is that the regulations about which channels you may or may not use vary from country to country. If the router senses a weather radar station or anything else on that channel, then it will automatically move to another channel. So please do make sure that you select the right country here. Thank you. On the Wi-Fi status page, you can see that I do have clients connected at very high speed here. Let's see if they are using it. First, here is the window that shows the CPU utilization. I'm running HTOP directly inside an SSH session on the router. At the moment, the CPU is idle. Now, let's connect the first device. CPU goes to roughly 60%, I'd say. For better visualization, I have modified a little Python program that I have found on GitHub in order to show the iPerf data in this gauge here. You can find the software on my GitHub repository. Check the description of the video, please. The first client shortly went up to 820 megabits. Then it gets somewhere around 700 to 750 megabits, but quite reliably, quite good. When I add the second client, then that drops to roughly 200 megabits, but remains stable. The second client gets up to 550 megabits here. Adding the third client, And that is where the beauty happens. They get a quite good bandwidth each, totaling to roughly 750 megabits. When I remove one client, then the remaining two instantly claim the total bandwidth. Beautiful. During all these tests, the CPU remains stable at about 60%, which leaves room for more. From a total bandwidth utilization standpoint, as far as I can judge, we are not using all available streams here. We seem to be stuck at roughly 800 megabits maximum. But hey, it's not worse than with a stock firmware, right? So in a nutshell, at the moment I do not seem to get better bandwidth with OpenWrt than what we had before with the original firmware. I'll need to check the forums and mailing lists to see where we are with this. But the good news is that we have much more options to choose from, especially in the light of using the additional channels. And, of course, the most important takeaway here is that the multi-user MIMO and beamforming seem to work well. Overall conclusion of the tests, the performance is pretty much the same with stock and OpenWrt. However, OpenWrt gives you much more possibilities, such as using multiple VLANs for different SSIDs, which you can't do with stock, or using more available channels, fast roaming and the like. Those things are not available to configure in the stock firmware. And I haven't even talked about the thousands of software packages that you may install, such as WireGuard, OpenVPN, etc., plus the much more granular configuration of the firewall and so on. To me, it's a clear go for OpenWrt. Even though, guys, you need to keep in mind that the current status as of January 2022 is still development. You may brick your router if you upload the wrong firmware and might need to open the case in order to unbrick it. That actually happened to me because I had flashed the wrong image. I then had to use a serial cable to unbrick it. I will show in detail how to flash OpenWrt and how to unbrick the device in a different episode. Please check the related videos up here and make sure that you subscribe to my channel so that you won't miss future episodes. Until then, many thanks for watching, liking, and subscribing to my channel. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.